Stanley? Harley? The fire?
Listen to me! I have to leave you!
Wait! No! You can't!
Can I see
those
her?
Those vents there!
Please!
If I just let the steam out, they'll keep the fire away from you. But I can't do it from here.
Don't leave! Not yet!
You'll Where's be it? Fine! I promise!
Wait, she was cold before.
Please, stay with me.
Can't see her though from here. Oh boy, more. I'm guessing we don't go back, we go this way. Here's the other seat. And another seat. Oh, that was weird. I can't get past the box. Okay.
Jesus Christ! I'm back to where I started.
Are we? Yeah, I thought it looked familiar. Are we going in there? I guess so. I guess we used our pass card. Oh. Back to the cold again.
Freezing in here. It's so cold.
Are we gonna make it? Ah.
Oh. At least it's warm in here.
Opening the door, I guess, so we want to go we gotta go through there.
There's one.
Alright, so we want to hit these. Huh? Again, look like we're in a cell. Coming. There was a way that seems right to a man, but its end is the way of death. Proverbs 14:12. Getting cold again. Ooh.
The valve. Almost finished.
Wow. No! Is this part- are we dying or- I guess so.
Stanley.
Oh, could we not make that? Was that impossible?
Leonor. Even through these heavy stone walls, I still hear your voice. Even as this coal slips like a knife into my bones, I still feel you with me. And yet, here at the end, I hardly know where to begin. The words are difficult to say, but I think it's finally time I finish my unfinished story. Through all our years together, you must have known what I've done, but you never asked me about it, never accused me of anything, so I've never spoken the truth.
He did do it.
After my father died, I wanted to lash out. And when Michael gave me a chance for revenge, I took it. But when I placed that bomb in the pub, I didn't avenge my father. I betrayed him. And it's haunted my nightmares ever since. I feel the heat of the blast, hear the screams of the wounded. I can taste the dust and smell the blood. But all I can see is her little scarf like a crimson river flowing out of the rubble.
Yeah.
Every night they return, nightmares of her. I see her entering the pub, reaching up to hold her father's hand. I call out to her, "Don't go in," but she never hears. She always goes through that door.
She went right in the bathroom.
You didn't deserve the life you gave me. And you don't deserve the life I've given you. You rescued me from prison, but you've been paying for my sins ever since. You sacrificed everything to run with me.
That's why the nightmares...
It's time you left my nightmares behind.
And the depression.
Without me, you can be free. Without me, you can go home. Leonor, you are my light. Goodbye.
Rescue one.
We have one survivor. Patient is female. She's slightly hypotensive at 90 over 60. Respiratory rate is 14 and O2 stats are good in the 90s. We have immobilized her leg and started warming measures. She's pretty blue, but she's still with us.
So they saved her. But she'll never know that he did bomb the place. I mean, he was saying it, but there's no way she could have heard him from there. So he saved her life and he died of hypothermia. I sincerely, you're welcome for me finishing the Fidelio incident. Thanks for watching, guys. Let me know what you think. What you thought. Think, thought, thinking. This was billed as a horror, but there is no horror in this. It was just horror, like horror of the humanity. The lives lost and the little girl. Anyway, I enjoyed it, and another nice short game. Kind of a walking sim, but the puzzles made it more interesting. I want to thank you guys for watching. See you next time. And always, seek adventure. Leonor's journal. Are these all the pages or all the pages we found? I think this one is one we didn't find. This is all the journal entries. I'm gonna turn my mic off and just play them all. I'll let her read them. Thanks again for watching, guys. See you in a guys in another Let's Play. And always, seek adventure.
Molly and I snuck out to a party tonight. It was in full swing by the time we got there, meaning all the boys were bollocksed. Well, not all. We weren't there long when this beautiful lad hands me a beer and said his name was Cullen. Oh, he was tall with bright green eyes and he wore neon-coloured runners. I asked him if it was his party. He shook his head and said that knew it was my party. Then he turned and waved his hand around like he was the great fucking Gatsby. And the first thing we saw was Stanley Whittaker throwing up in the kitchen sink. I laughed and said he could have his party back. Oh, we blathered for a while and we were really getting on when Stanley Whittaker stumbled over and asked Cullen if he ever wore those shoes outside. And before I could tell him to fuck off, Stanley asked Cullen if he knew I was the daughter of Michael O'Shea. I felt my legs go numb. Cullen couldn't get away from me fast enough. Molly and I were at Rory's pub when in walked Stanley Whittaker. I picked up my pint and walked over to meet him in the middle of the room. When he saw me coming, his eyes lit up with this big, beautiful, goofy smile. I threw him a drink in his face. Then I grabbed him by his collar and I told him to keep his big trap shut about my father. Stanley blinked away the beer and said he was only looking out for me because Mr. Fancy Shoes was just too good looking and that I should have a plain fella so everyone would notice the beautiful woman. He said I was luminous. Then he said people would also know that I'm brave. God knows why, but I laughed and I asked him, oh, why am I brave? Oh, you'd have to be, he said, to be seen with a bloke like me. Well, the entire pub burst into laughter. And then Rory threw him a towel and Stanley caught it without taking his eyes off me. They were the bluest things I'd ever seen. The bastard. Can't wait to see him again. Stanley and I decided to venture farther into the city tonight. He said we shouldn't cross into East Belfast, but I didn't care. I was feeling brave. When we saw the party, it looked deadly, so I dragged Stanley up the steps. I love going to parties where nobody knows me. I can be anyone I want. I told Stanley to pretend this was our house. We wandered about, making up stories about where we got each bit of furniture. I was talking about the grandfather clock from Borneo when some drunken arse turns and tells me I'm full of shite. Turned out he owned the house. Then he asked us where we came from. A crowd started to gather, and the wrong answer could have spelled trouble. Stanley threw his arm around the man and said, we're from Texas, America. And the man's face lit up. He loved America. Stanley's accent was ridiculous, but his confidence was inspiring, so they believed every word. It was wonderful. Stanley took me to this lovely old tree on the cliffs overlooking the sea. It was just the perfect spot. Then I saw there were notches carved into the trunk. I pointed them out to him and asked him how many other girls had he brought here. Stanley laughed and said when he was just a lad, he and his dad would come to the same spot for picnics, and Paddy would notch the tree to show how much Stanley had grown. I turned as red as a beetroot and muttered some kind of apology. When we sat down to eat lunch, I saw another notch at the base of the tree. When I asked him what that one was for, he winked and said, Margaret Kane. Mother begged me not to go, but I assured her it was a peaceful rally. Molly wouldn't go with me. She was afraid the army would show up. So I dragged Stanley with me. I thought for sure he'd want to be there because his father was one of the speakers. Paddy Whittaker was an electrifying presence. People were cheering and clapping as he spoke about the end to the violence, a peaceful end to the troubles. He spoke with such conviction, I nearly wept. But when I looked over at Stanley, he was wearing fucking headphones and messing with his cassette player. He said he'd heard it all before. I couldn't believe it. He has no idea how lucky he is. I don't know what's wrong with that man. Stanley came into Rory's pub tonight, sweaty and out of breath. His eye was swollen, his lip was bleeding, and he looked as proud as a peacock. He and one of his no-good mates went messing into East Belfast to stir up trouble. Stanley had the brilliant idea to spray the Story Plough over a unionist mural, but they got caught by some locals and they got into a scrap. Rory thought that was a gas and bought Stanley a pint. I told Stanley he was an idiot. What if he'd been caught by the guard or the UVF? They'd have bloody killed him. But he was just too proud of himself to listen. Stanley can still surprise me, even after all this time. We drove out for a picnic at our tree by the ocean, but when we got there, Stanley pulled a guitar case out of the boot. I had no idea he played guitar. All afternoon we laid together, in the grass, under the tree, while Stanley strummed and plucked away. It was grand. Then he told me to close my eyes. I told him he better not have any funny ideas. And he said he tried learning a new song just for me. After a few bars, it started to sound familiar. But I couldn't stop myself from kissing him before he could finish the song. I'll let him finish it for me someday. Belfast is so cold, the air feels brittle in my lungs. No matter what I do, I just can't seem to get warm. The other night at Rory's pub, I asked Stanley if he'd take me someplace warm, like another country. He said that if he did, we'd never come back. But the thought of it sounded so grand. We spent the rest of the night talking about travelling to exotic lands, how we'd meet people we couldn't understand, and we'd eat spicy food until our faces flushed and the sweat ran down our backs. I don't think he knew how serious I was. We should leave this broken island while we still have a chance. Mother's crying in the next room. She says it's because she's happy, but I don't believe her. My father is getting out of prison. My friends protest the unlawful imprisonments, but I wish they'd kept Michael O'Shea locked up forever. Life in prison isn't long enough for him. It would kill my mother if she ever read this. What if Michael ever read it? Would it kill him? Or would he kill me? Well, the violence didn't stop when he was on the inside. But at least when I read about something terrible in the paper, I knew my father wasn't the cause. But now, God help us all. My face hurts from trying to smile all night. I can't blame Stanley. There's no way he could have known. He's not that cruel. He knew I was named after Beethoven's opera and just assumed that I'd be a fan. But it was my father who loved the opera. He'd blast those records into the night and stagger about with a half-empty bottle, waving it in time with the music. It was terrifying. But I love Stanley. So I gripped his hand and smiled through the entire performance. Mother Mary, Paddy has been killed. The British papers named it the Boxing Day Raid. Here they're calling it the Wren's Day Massacre. 7 people shot down on the day after Christmas. I don't know what they're meeting about and I don't want to know. They were all violent men except for Stanley's father. What was Paddy Whittaker doing there? How did he hear about the meeting? Was he trying to talk them out of whatever they were planning? I need to find Stanley. He must be going through hell. So many funerals today. I was with Stanley at his father's funeral. There was quite a crowd of people. I told Stanley his father would be proud of the turnout, but he said Paddy would just want to make a speech. The police were watching the crowd, but they didn't bother anyone. They were hidden, but I spotted them straight away. I had to help Stanley write the eulogy for Paddy. But when it came time to read it, he couldn't speak. He gripped the sides of the lectern so hard, I feared it would splinter in his hands. Finally, Stanley said Paddy was the speechmaker, but he wasn't enough like his father to do him justice. He just folded up the speech and left in silence. Rory hosted a wake at his pub for the victims of Wednesday. I think he was just trying to show off. He got arrested last year for dealing, and the police broke his hand, so suddenly he's all political. Stanley and I sat in the car for a long time, watching the front door swallow all the black suits until the pub looked like it was filled with ink. Stanley opened the car door, but I grabbed his arm and asked him to take me to our tree. I felt a crippling anxiety that if I went into that black pub, I'd never see the sky again. Stanley didn't say a word. He just started the car, and we drove away. We hadn't been to the ocean since spring, and it was a shock to see our tree so barren and frail. As we walked, Stanley wrapped his coat around my shoulders. It was still warm from his body, and I pulled the collar up to my nose to see if it still smelled like him. It didn't. It just smelled of dust and mothballs. Stanley said his father would bring him here and say, "This is why we struggle." He thinks that now he finally understands what his father meant. But I wonder. I laid the jacket on the ground and pulled us both onto it. I just wanted to make him forget the rest of the day. I wanted to forget the rest of the world except for him. The grass was itchy and dry, and the sky was as white as butcher paper. Neither of us bothered to speak another word. The cold wind would have just carried our words away.
I don't know what's going on with Stanley. I'm afraid he's gone mad. Tonight I was waiting for him at Rory's pub. Rory was complaining about his fucking hand again. When Stanley finally showed up, he looked white as a ghost. He grabbed my elbow and said we had to go. I'd been there a while, so I was in no mood to be handled. I told him to sit down while I finished my pint. But he snatched it from my hand and smashed it on the floor. Rory started shouting bloody murder, and that's when Stanley went for him. He threw himself at Rory, clutching for his throat. Rory was so shocked he slipped and fell to the floor. It took all my strength to pull Stanley off and drag him toward the front door. Rory stayed behind the bar, cursing all the Whittakers. I thought things were getting better. I had hoped we were moving forward. I believed in Paddy Whittaker's message. Violence can't be the answer. But now, he's gone. Rory's pub was bombed last night. Thank the Holy Mother, Rory closed the pub for his birthday party, but 16 people died. One of the victims was a little girl. The last time we were attacked like this, my father went mad. He poured liquor on his anger until it was an inferno that nearly engulfed us all. Now, he's as silent as the grave. And that's even more terrifying.
I can hardly feel the pin in my fingers. My whole body is numb. I can hardly see the words on the page. I can't stop crying. They've taken away my heart. Stanley has been arrested for the bombing of Rory's pub. Someone must have set him up. I asked my father if he knew who would do this to Stanley. He just said that I should move on. Stanley won't live long inside prison. I nearly spit in his eye. I swear by all that's holy, if I find out that he had anything to do with Stanley being arrested, I'll burn him alive.
I will not be a prisoner's wife. I will not become like those other empty wives, like my mother. I will not be looked after or taken care of, isolated. There is no light without him. He is my heart, and I cannot live without my heart. I'll do whatever it takes to get him out. I will not be a prisoner's wife.
Everything is in place, but the air feels hollow and empty in my chest. Oh, I can hear my heart pounding in my ears. In just a few hours, life as I know it will be over. But that's only if I'm very lucky. Otherwise, my life will just be Today I'm rescuing Stanley. Molly works at the prison. She was worried about taking the job, but my father insisted it was good to have one of our own on the inside. He just wanted to use her. But it turns out, I'm the one putting her at risk. She got the powder inside, and there's a lad from the neighbourhood who will slip it into Stanley's breakfast. If he eats enough, the pain in his guts will be so bad they'll transfer him to the hospital. But if he eats too much, it could kill him. Until now, I never knew how much my father hated Stanley. And the man has always had his secrets, but he's never just lied to me. He tried to tell me about why Stanley was really arrested and the truth about Rory Cochrane. But I can't believe what he said about Stanley. I can't. All those people. Stanley would never. I couldn't go to my father for help. He's all for letting Stanley take the fall. But the mad bastard with me today didn't know that, so he did everything I told him, including stealing an ambulance. Molly called us about Stanley's medical transfer, which gave us a head start on the real ambulance. I looked ridiculous in the uniform, but her documents were perfect, so I kept my head up and let Stanley inspire my confidence. Even so, I nearly fainted when the guard wheeled him out on the gurney. He looked dead already. The guards loaded him on board, and I drove us away. 5 minutes out, and the mad bastard dosed both the guards with anesthesia. And just like that, Stanley was free. Stanley's trying to be brave, but I can say he's still in pain. I was able to secure flawless passports and a boat for the captain who doesn't ask questions. There are so many inlets on the western coast, we'll make landfall in complete secrecy. The entire world is open to us. The entire world except for Ireland, but I won't miss it for a second. We have a new life now. Together. The summers in Munich are beautiful. The palazzos are full of tourists, so Stanley and I blend right in. But even in the sea of anonymous faces, we have to be careful. Today, I was sitting in the park with my lunch when this young man with a big fancy camera came up to me. He was handsome and stylish, a real artsy type, and he asked if he could take some photos of me. Obviously, I had to say no. But then he said something that caught me off guard. He said that my eyes were the saddest he'd ever seen. "Of course they are," I said. "I'm Irish." I left everything on the bench and disappeared into the crowd. There were so many people in the market, I couldn't hear myself think. I needed to get out of there. But when I asked Stanley to choose something for supper, he just replied with his usual, "Whatever you want." I wanted him to make a decision for once so I could stop thinking about absolutely everything all the time. The bags were so heavy and my hands were cramping. Someone close by smelled like goat. It may have even been me. So I dropped everything and let the bags spill all over the street. I didn't care. I'm sick of the crowds and the stink of curry and I'm sick of the hate. I want to walk through green grass. I want to feel cool air on my skin. Under a sky the colour of butcher paper. I can't stop thinking about the dream. We were flying in the plane, but I wasn't afraid. I was giddy with excitement because we were flying back to Ireland. Stanley dove the plane so fast I could feel my stomach floating. And we were laughing like we haven't laughed in ages. As we dipped out of the clouds and swooped in over the ocean, I could see the white cliffs and green hills. Stone walls and hedges divided the patchwork fields dotted with livestock. And our tray welcoming us home. Then I woke up in this hot, filthy room, dripping with sweat. Stanley's still sleeping. No nightmares, thank God. Maybe it's my turn. Why I keep these damn journals. There are so many things I wish I could forget. Today at the school site, my senses were filled with the buzzing of insects and the smell of the jungle. But then, all at once, I thought I was back in Belfast. The air rocked with a heavy thud of a bomb exploding. Stanley took off in a dead run towards the sound. A cow had set off an old landmine, and there was a man at the edge of the field shouting for everyone to stay back. But Stanley, he charged past him, splashing into the mud. I wanted to stop him. My voice froze in my throat when I saw Stanley lift the tiny body out of the grass. The boy's name was Udom. He had been walking with the cow. Udom's father collapsed, Stanley gently passed the boy to him. Udom's father kept apologizing over and over for not protecting him from the evils brought to this village.
I was afraid of this. I knew from the moment I saw Stanley clutching that tiny body in his arms that the nightmares would come back. They're worse than ever. I can feel Stanley's heart breaking with every shuddering breath. I heard him say, "Don't go." Is he talking to me? I'll never leave him.